Welcome back, everyone. It's Charlie. This will be my Blue Beetle post-credit scene. Explain what's happening with the character going forward. There's a whole bunch of stuff that happened at the ending. James Gunn has talked a lot about what he's doing with his new DCEU movies and how Blue Beetle is going to be a part of that. Some of the other characters too. Maybe not everybody, but they will be able to pay off some of the events of the post-credit scene, as opposed to, say, like The Flash, where they had to change a bunch of things at the ending because they had Henry Cavill's Superman, they had Michael Keaton's Batman, they had Supergirl doing a whole bunch of different things that they were never going to pay off. So they had them remove that from The Flash, as opposed to Blue Beetle. If you're brand new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to get all the videos. There's a bunch of big stuff coming up. Ahsoka episodes also premiering next week. I'll be doing videos for that. So careful for spoilers if you have not seen Blue Beetle yet. But at the end of the movie, Carapax, the villain, turns into a version of Brother Eye, the OMAC project from the comics. Now, it's the OMAC project that turns into Brother Eye using the Blue Beetle code that they derive from the Scarab. That allows Victoria Kor to basically turn his OMAC suit from the comics into Brother Eye. Like, it evolves the same way that Blue Beetle's costume evolves. Carapax becomes like the Giga Chad version of himself, almost winds up killing Blue Beetle and the rest of his family, Jenny Cord. Blue Beetle almost dies and is almost separated from the Khal Shaddaa consciousness, the consciousness of the Scarab itself, played by Becky G. Earlier in the movie, his father died and speaks to him in the afterlife saying that it's not his time, sort of like this ethereal space. They don't get too technical on it, and it's not something from the comics. Like, this is just something that the movie introduced for this scene. He's barely conscious. He's on the edge of death, but his brainwaves are able to sync with Khal Shaddaa's, the Blue Beetle Scarab, and they're able to come back to consciousness, and eventually the Blue Beetle Scarab reboots itself because it is technically hardware. They're able to overpower Carapax, and the Blue Beetle Scarab Khal Shaddaa comes around on him because they've become this symbiotic relationship. She starts to come around to his line of thinking and prevents him from killing Carapax. That was a big plot point earlier in the movie where he tried to prevent Khal Shaddaa from killing a bunch of other people using its powers. Sort of like the Batman thing, like no actual killing. Carapax winds up sacrificing himself because he senses what he's become. He remembers everything that Victoria Kor did to him when he was younger, basically chopping up his body to experiment on it and create the OMAC project. Essentially, they turned him into one of the OMAC cyborgs from the Infinite Crisis storyline, which was created by Batman in the comics. The satellite, Brother Eye, and OMAC eventually evolved on their own and sort of left Batman's programming and went rogue and turned into this big villain. They go back to Palmera City, and because Victoria Kor has died, Jenny Kor becomes the new CEO of the company and dedicates them to helping the world, not making weapons anymore. Very Iron Man, Stark Industries kind of twist. She and Blue Beetle start their relationship and then just start having fun together, basically implying that they're going to continue acting as Blue Beetle and she'll be like his Bulma, so to speak, to make a Dragon Ball reference. There are a lot of anime references during the movie. Basically, she has all this cool tech left over from Ted Kord, her father, that will help him be a superhero. She uses Kord Industries money to replace their house that had burned down, and the family sort of comes back together again, but the father has died, so they kind of mourn him. The community rallies around them, so it's a bit of a happy ending. The actual credits are blue and violet colored for Blue Beetle colors and Kord Industries colors. During the first post-credit scene, there's a signal coming from inside Ted Kord's Blue Beetle cape, like his bat cape, so to speak. The song All Out of Love plays because every time they go into the cave, there's always some 80s song that plays because that's basically the era where he disappeared when Jenny Kord was a little girl. That's why all the tech inside the cave looks like it's from the 80s and early 90s because that was the time where he disappeared. The signal is coming from him, Ted Kord. There's a bunch of satellite signals that bounce around, like all these systems activate on the computer. And this fuzzy broadcast from him, like a message, says, "Tell my daughter, Jenny Kord, that her father is still alive. Ted Kord is still alive." While that signal plays, the camera zooms in on that third mannequin that's black with the pillow tied around it. That's meant to represent Jenny Kord. Eventually, I think the idea was when she was younger and she would visit the cave with Ted Kord. Ted Kord had always intended for her to get her own suit and was going to make it and put it on that mannequin. Like, the mannequin was meant to represent her eventual suit when she grew big enough. So the idea is that she'll get a super suit like Ted Kord's Blue Beetle suit, not like another Scarab. There was a theory that she would get a Scarab in a future movie because they have a bunch of Scarabs at the beginning during the opening credits, just showing them going all over the universe. So it'll be like a man-made suit. I think this also works too because she is Jenny Kord's daughter, so she'll use tech that he had, basically be the Bulma, like I said, in the Dragon Ball equation of this. It's not totally clear who the actor is that's playing Ted Kord in this scene. They could always wind up recasting that person in the future James Gunn DCU movies, but I think the idea is they said that they would bring Jenny Kord back, and we know that Blue Beetle will come back as a character. It's not totally clear if James Gunn intends on paying off this Ted Kord actor or if he'll try to explain that in some other way. But if he's bringing these characters back, they had this post-credit scene, they'll probably try to pay off this post-credit scene at least in some way. The early theory is that he got lost because he was researching something about the Reach. Like, he learned all these details about how the Scarab was alien, quote-unquote, and had something to do with his professor, Dan Garrett, which is also right out of the comics, too, in Blue Beetle comic book history. Dan Garrett's Blue Beetle suit is right here next to Ted Kord's Blue Beetle suit. So the idea is that Dan Garrett was a character inside the movie. They reference him at the very beginning in the opening credits. What probably wound up happening is that he disappeared when he found out about the Reach, and it sounds like he also hid the Scarab, which Victoria Kord was looking for at the beginning of the movie. So it's not necessarily a post-credit scene all about the Reach. That was one of my early theories, too, is that they would tease the coming of the Reach, because that's like the whole big bad of the entire Blue Beetle comic book storyline. But what they can do in James Gunn's future DCEU movies, because they're all meant to be interconnected, and we know the Green Lantern is coming, Nathan Fillion is going to be a version of Guy Gardner in Superman Legacy, we know they're going to do the Booster Gold TV show, and Blue Beetle is supposed to cross over onto that. They can pay off all this Reach stuff, this storyline, during some of those upcoming movies. The second post-credit scene is just a longer version of that animated Latin American TV show El Chapo Yin Colorado that they used to distract the Kord Industries guards earlier in the movie when they were using his uncle's machine. The actual clip in the post-credit scene introduces the character's comic powers, like within the context of the TV show itself. The short animation, which is in Spanish, explains to the public how the Chapo Yin is more agile than a turtle, stronger than a mouse, nobler than a lettuce. For those that grew up in Latin American countries, it's meant to be this hilarious callback to a TV show that they all watched during childhood. The director said that for everybody else, though, like if you didn't grow up in a Latin American country, it just meant to be this funny slapstick TV show, like just a funny moment, paying off a funny moment from earlier in the movie. The actual character, El Chapo Yin, is a character created by Robert Gomez Bolaños, this legendary writer, actor, director that had a comedy show in the 1970s named Chespirito. Chapo Yin is a superhero that appeared multiple times on that show. Every time someone needed him, he would show up, help, only to cause more trouble due to his clumsiness, which they show in the post-credit scene. So part of the idea here is they're also paying homage to this superhero TV show from the 1970s that started before, say, like the Incredible Hulk TV show, like American superhero TV shows from Marvel and DC. The actual character wound up getting its own spin-off TV show after that that ran for like 8 seasons and 260 episodes. It became this really highly popular character within Latin American culture. At the end of the clip, you hear George Lopez's voice, and he's kicking like a giant machine, saying, "That's sexy." It's probably dialogue taken from earlier in the movie when he was distracting the guards with his machine and had to kick it a bunch of times to get it to work. There's a lot of Latin American culture sprinkled into the movie. Like earlier in the movie, the grandmother is watching a bunch of telenovelas and a bunch of Hispanic TV shows. So a lot of people have asked what's going to happen to Blue Beetle after this. I think short term, he's going to show up on, say, like the Booster Gold TV show, crossover to that. Maybe we'll see some crossovers with the Peacemaker character, because he actually did crossover with Peacemaker in the comics. And it feels like those two characters would just work well together in brief episodes or in part of a movie or something like that. The actor Cholo did say that Batman was one of his all-time favorite characters and he wanted to cross over with Batman in the future. They're introducing the new DCU version of Batman in Brave and the Bold, but that won't be for a couple more years, so he might eventually cross over with the other Justice League characters. I think that's part of the idea.
I'm a sucker for Batman. Yes, I know right. Everyone says Batman. I also love Batman. I like Harley Quinn. Oh. I like the stuff that they do, especially in the cartoons.
DC animation. Yeah.
DC animation. The animated Batman movies are some of my favorite. And I like Dr. Fate. He's also cool.
One.
Young Justice. That's kind of where I've seen most of my DC content.
They did say that they set things up for a sequel. Like, that's what the Ted Kord scene is specifically meant to do in the post-credit scene, is for a sequel. But I don't think that they will do Blue Beetle 2, even if the box office does well. What they'll probably do is they'll just fold all these characters into upcoming DC projects. If you spotted any other Easter eggs or references in the post-credit scene, just write them below in the comments. If you have questions about the futures of the characters, I'll try to address those in the comments. My full breakdown and Easter eggs video will post in the next day or so. And big reminder, the Ahsoka episodes are now starting a day early, and they're going to air Tuesday night Pacific time. Make sure to enable alerts for my channel so you don't miss any of that stuff. Click here for that full Blue Beetle breakdown Easter eggs. I'll update the link as soon as I post that video. And click here to learn about Daredevil Born Again, that first look with Spider-Man, Punisher coming back, and a whole bunch of Marvel Netflix characters. Thank you so much for watching. Everyone stay safe, and I'll see you guys in the next one.